Good evening. My name is Rita Niles, and on behalf of Father Walsh, Deacon Marty, and our parish community, we want to thank you for joining us as we celebrate the Passion of the Lord. Let us join together in sharing in the suffering of Christ this day, ever mindful of his great love and mercy for each and every one of us. We will begin tonight's liturgy in silence.
Let us pray. Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see, those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces. Spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings he endured, while we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong, nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your justice, rescue me. Into your hands, I commend my spirit. You will redeem me, O Lord, O faithful God. For all my foes, I am an object of reproach, a laughingstock to my neighbors, and a dread to my friends. They who see me abroad flee from me. I am forgotten like the unremembered dead. I am like a dish that is broken. But my trust is in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. In your hands is my destiny. Rescue me from the clutches of my enemies and my persecutors. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your kindness. Take courage and be stout-hearted, all you hope in the Lord. A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you're looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guard seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. The other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was the gatekeeper said to Peter,
You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?
He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made,
because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there, keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of the disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning. They themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him,
"If he were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute anyone."
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, he indicating the kind of death that he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king."
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Not this one, but Barabbas."
Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak, and Pilate said to them,
"Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God."
Now, when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and I have the power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in a place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
"Behold, your king."
They cried out,
"Take him away, take him away, crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
"We have no king but Caesar."
So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, 'I am the King of the Jews.'"
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven into one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
"Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be."
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots." This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, and in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And, bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Because it was preparation day, and in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first, and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you may also come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled, "Not a bone of it will be broken." And again, another passage says, "They will look upon him whom they have pierced." After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths, along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now, in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord
Jesus Christ.
About 30 years ago, I went to a church in the Archdiocese of Newark. Don't know which church it was. It was an old church. And when you went in, it'd be kind of like where our vestibule is. When you first went in, right on a wall, on a pillar, was a large cross and a corpus, the body of Christ. And it was a little bit larger than life. So maybe one and a half times the size of a normal person. And it was set at an elevation, such that when you went in, your face was kind of right, you know, Jesus' feet were here, and the lower half of his shin was right here, and then all the rest was up here. So the only part you could conveniently touch was the feet and the lower part of the shin. And it had been there for decades, because it was an old church. And what had happened was the wood was very dark there. So you got the corpus, normal color wood, but down here where people could touch, it had turned very, very dark. And it turned dark because of all the decades of people coming in there and touching that, you know, between the oil in our hands and the sweat, it had kind of turned a darker, noticeable wood. And, you know, I was thinking of that because the people came in and they touched that corpus for various reasons. I'm sure some of them, they would come in to touch that corpus and put their hand on his feet and then on his shin in gratitude for a prayer being answered. But my guess would be the vast majority of people who touched that shin and those hands through those decades came in and did it for one of three reasons. First one is they were racked with worry and fear. So fear over something about children, grandchildren, parents, fear about illness and what the future held, fears about transitions in life. I think a second thing that many people came in, they were there to beg. They were begging God for something. And they had those hands on there and they were asking for a miracle. And some of that that darkened wood was from people placing their hands on there, and they were in a lot of sorrow and pain and anger. And maybe they were in anger because prayer was not answered. And maybe they were in pain because of having to make an agonizing decision. Or maybe they were in pain because of the loss of a loved one, loss of a job, loss of a marriage, loss of a dream. And it just reminded me as I reflect on today that, you know, we walk with Christ on the road to Calvary many times in our life. Those moments that we symbolically put our hands on him And we kind of have a feel for what he went through. Not to the degree, of course, but we go through similar steps to what he did. So for example, some of our suffering. Here at the First Station, he is condemned to death, and it was not fair. It was not fair. And some of the suffering that we go through in our life, it is not fair. And then that second station, he picks up his cross. And sometimes we have no choice. Based on that first day, we have no choice but to pick up the cross. We don't want to pick it up, but we have no choice. And then in the third, seventh, and ninth station, he falls under the weight of the cross. And sometimes we, in the crosses that we get in life, you know, we fall either be it physically sometimes, but also emotionally and spiritually. Along the way, he received support. And he received support from Veronica, from his mother, from Simon of Cyrene, and from the holy women of Jerusalem. And in our carrying of our cross, you know, in this life, hopefully we've got some family and some friends and some parish family members that help us walk with our cross. They can't take away the cross, but they can make it easier to carry the cross. Then in 10 and 11 over here, he is really stripped of his dignity. Some of the crosses we carry in life will strip us of our dignity. And of course, he dies on the 12th station. And it makes us think, you know, why do we call it Good Friday? That's how people say, why do you call it Good Friday? He suffered and died. And of course, the reason is that without a Good Friday, there could never be an Easter Sunday. You know, the Easter Sunday, how would we ever know what would happen to us at our death if he didn't die and rise? And that was his way to die for all of our sins. Remember in the Old Testament, they always, when they were sinning, they were always sacrificing animals. That was their way to try to say, I'm sorry to God, sacrifice animals. And he says, stop it. And he dies for our sins. And so that's why we call it Good Friday, because there would never be a resurrection, and we would never know what happens to us in our death if there wasn't an Easter Sunday. And that's why it was a year ago right now, we were just kind of starting that pandemic, that one of the thoughts for the week that I mentioned was, there's a blessing in every burden. That was one of our thoughts for the week as we left. And there's no greater example of that than Good Friday to Easter Sunday. That's more than a burden. That is absolute anguish, what our Lord went through. But the blessing is the resurrection. And I would love to be able to somehow find out of the thousands of people who touched that corpus at that church, somewhere in that archdiocese, the thousands of hands, if we could ever find out, did you find the blessing in your burden? And I think some would come back and say, yes, there was a blessing in the burden that I was carrying. But many would say no. And it just shows us that sometimes, you know, this suffering, we've got to wait till we get to the other side to see where the blessing is. We get a chance to see it sometimes here, but most of these burdens we go through, we got to wait till we get to the other side to find out where the blessing is. For our communion here, I know we have some people that are new with us, and we're awful glad you're here. We will be receiving communion. Remember, this is the one day of the year we don't celebrate Mass. But last night, we consecrate enough hosts so that we can receive communion tonight. And so we will be distributing communion. Just a quick reminder, we've got ambassadors that'll help us come up to receive safely. Just watch their promptings. And when you come up, just have your mask on. We'll have our masks on. We just make a little basket with our hand. We drop the host in the hand. And then if you just move off to the left or right, 6 feet or 12 feet, and just remove the mask and receive the host, put the mask back on and return by the sides. Deacon Marty, who will be down in the parish center, he has gluten-free hosts. I have gluten-free hosts as well. If you need a gluten-free host, just get in my line. Sometimes people just prefer a blessing. versus communion. And if you just come up with your hands across your chest, we'll know that you would prefer just a blessing. And please stand for our prayer of the faithful. These petitions we do here in Good Friday, there's 10 of them, and every church in the world is doing the same 10 petitions all throughout the world.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her, and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Father Almighty.
Almighty ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout all the world may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for our Bishop Scharpfenberger, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for those entering our church, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord.
Almighty ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of those entering the church, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one church.
Almighty ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them the advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Almighty ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Almighty ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you and by finding you, come to rest, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to his will for the true peace and freedom of all.
Almighty ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because of their hour of need, your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray, dear brothers and sisters, to God, the Father Almighty, trusting in his love and providence, that he may continue to strengthen and to guide us in this time of difficulty and great need.
Almighty God, who sent us Jesus, your Son, as our divine physician and Savior, hear our heartfelt prayers for all who have fallen ill, for those who have died, for those who are vulnerable and fearful, and for those who work for healing, that they may be sure in faith, strong in hope, perfected in love, and so experience the grace of deliverance, through Christ our Lord. And please be seated.
This is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world.
Come, let us worship.
This is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world.
Come, let us worship.
This is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world.
Come, let us worship.
who would normally do the veneration of the cross at this time, but with COVID, we want to be careful. So I'm going to leave the cross here. Brian and Sam are going to play a piece of music for us, and maybe we just meditate on the cross from our seats. Please stand. And at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And please kneel. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.